Welcome to Chronicles of Time Sleep Stories. Finding moments of peace in the hustle and bustle of our lives can be a bit challenging. Our channel is your sanctuary, a place where captivating tales blend with soothing tones, guiding you toward restful slumber. Escape from the noise, let go of the day's stresses, and allow our stories to transport you to realms of tranquility and dreams. Whether you're seeking relaxation, meditation, or simply a good night's sleep, you're in the right place. So, settle in, close your eyes, and let the journey to serenity begin. In our unceasing journey through the corridors of life, moments of pure, unadulterated tranquility can sometimes seem as elusive as shadows at noon. The modern world is a symphony of endless noises, from the incessant hum of digital screens to the ceaseless whispers of obligations, commitments, and desires. In this symphony, our souls often search for a gentle lullaby, a melodious escape, a chance to pause, breathe, and simply be. Now, as you find yourself here in the magic of this narrative oasis, know that you've stumbled upon a sanctuary, a world where serenity isn't just a luxury, but a promise. Picture, if you will, a secluded haven nestled amidst nature's embrace, where the wind hums lullabies, and time itself seems to tread lightly. This is where we invite you to journey with us, a place of meditation, reflection, and utter calm. Begin by taking a deep, resolute breath. Feel the cool air grace your nostrils, traveling through the depths of your lungs, filling your being with the ancient rhythms of existence. And then, as you exhale, imagine releasing the shackles of worry, stress, and the relentless march of time. Each subsequent breath is a step deeper into the heart of tranquility, a dance with the universe, an affirmation of the present moment. We live in an era where the very essence of our existence often feels fragmented. Pulled in myriad directions by demands, expectations, and the invisible threads of technology, it's easy to lose oneself. But these tales, each a gem sculpted from the rich tapestries of imagination and insight, seek to offer you a bridge. A bridge not just to sleep, but that in itself is a cherished realm of restoration, but to a state of soulful relaxation, where the world narrows down to the here and now, where every heartbeat is a reminder of life's simple beauties. These stories are not just words. They are portals. They beckon you into worlds where the pace is gentler, the colors more vivid, and the sounds harmoniously aligned with the rhythms of the cosmos. Here, amidst these tales, you'll find characters and landscapes that resonate with the deepest parts of your psyche, invoking a sense of familiarity and nostalgia. They're like old friends or forgotten dreams, waiting to welcome you back. As you immerse yourself in these narratives, let the outside world fade into soft focus. Envision your stresses and anxieties as leaves carried away by a gentle stream, disappearing beyond the horizon. Let the weight of expectation, the clamor of responsibilities, and the noise of uncertainty be replaced by the soothing cadences of these stories. Every word, every phrase, is a brushstroke painting a world of peace, inviting you to step in and explore. Sleep, that precious gift, is not just a physical necessity but a balm for the soul. It's nature's way of healing, restoring, and rejuvenating. As you stand at the threshold of dreams, these tales are the gentle hands guiding you towards restful slumber. They remind you of the beauty of surrender, of letting go, of drifting into the comforting embrace of night. So, dear listener, as you embark on this journey with us, know that you are not alone. Through the magic of these tales, we are with you, sharing in your quest for tranquility and deep, restorative sleep. Let these stories be your anchor, your lighthouse, guiding you away from the tempests of daily life and into the calm waters of relaxation and dreams. Welcome to our sanctuary. Let the journey to serenity begin. The Black Knight of London. Chapter 1. Shadows over London. In the dark, winding streets of medieval London, where the fog hung heavy and the night air whispered of secrets and tales, there emerged a figure both enigmatic and formidable. He was known as the Black Knight, a mysterious guardian who patrolled the city under the cover of darkness. Clad in armor as dark as the night sky and riding a steed that moved like a shadow, Sir Marcus, a nobleman by daylight, transformed into this avenger when the sun set. The legend of the Black Knight was one whispered in hushed tones among the citizens of London. To the corrupt and the wicked, he was a specter of fear, a silent judge who meted out justice with a swift sword. To the oppressed and the downtrodden, he was a protector, a beacon of hope in a city riddled with crime and despair. Sir Marcus, in his guise as the Black Knight, had vowed to safeguard his city from the clutches of corruption that threatened to strangle its very heart. His journey as the city's clandestine guardian began when he stumbled upon a conspiracy that ran deeper than the dungeons of the Tower of London. The plot, shrouded in mystery and betrayal, was a venomous serpent coiled within the city's core, its fangs poised to strike at the heart of the crown. One chilly evening, as a thick fog enveloped the city, Sir Marcus rode through the cobblestone streets of London, his eyes vigilant, his senses attuned to the whispers of the night. As he passed through the shadowed alleyways of the Cheapside district, a faint conversation caught his attention. Hiding in the darkness, he overheard a clandestine meeting between a group of cloaked figures. Their words spoke of a sinister plot, a scheme brewing in the underbelly of the city. Determined to uncover the truth behind these ominous plans, Sir Marcus embarked on a perilous journey through London's darkest corners. His path led him through the labyrinthine back streets, where thieves and cutthroats lurked, to the dimly lit taverns where plots were hatched in hushed tones. Each clue he gathered wove a tapestry of intrigue that pointed to a conspiracy involving some of the city's most influential figures. Trust was a luxury Sir Marcus could ill afford, for the conspiracy seemed to entangle even those within the halls of power. His quest for the truth brought Sir Marcus to the infamous gallows of Tyburn, a place where justice and cruelty dance hand in hand. Under the cover of darkness, he infiltrated a gathering of thieves and miscreants, his armor concealed beneath a dark cloak. Amidst the raucous laughter and drunken banter, he gleaned valuable information, whispers of a plot against the royal family, of a rebellion brewing in the shadows. But the night was not without danger. His presence at the gallows did not go unnoticed, and soon, Sir Marcus found himself embroiled in a violent skirmish. Swords clashed in the moonlight, the ring of steel echoing through the night. The Black Knight's skill with the blade was unmatched, his strikes precise and deadly. In the heat of battle, he uncovered a crucial piece of the puzzle, a signet ring bearing the crest of a noble house, a key that unlocked the next chapter of his investigation. With the break of dawn, Sir Marcus retreated to the safety of his estate, his mind racing with the knight's revelations. The conspiracy was like a shadowy web, its strands stretching into the highest echelons of London society. The plot he had uncovered was more than a mere power play, it was a threat that could plunge the entire city into chaos. As he shed his armor, the weight of his responsibility weighed heavily on his shoulders. Sir Marcus knew that the path ahead would be fraught with danger and intrigue. But as the Black Knight, he was sworn to protect London at any cost. The city was his charge, and he would defend it against the impending storm. The streets of London may have been silent as the city awoke, but beneath the calm surface, a storm was brewing. And the Black Knight, the enigmatic guardian of the night, would be its bulwark against the tide of treachery and deceit. His adventure had just begun, and the shadows over London would soon reveal their secrets to his determined gaze. Chapter 2. The Whispering Gallows. The gallows of Tyburn, a place where justice and vengeance often intertwined, stood ominous and foreboding under the moonlit sky. It was here, amidst the echoes of past executions, that Sir Marcus, the Black Knight of London, found himself delving deeper into the labyrinth of conspiracy that threatened the very heart of the city. Disguised in a dark cloak, his identity concealed, Sir Marcus mingled with the underbelly of London that gathered at Tyburn. Thieves, cutthroats, and other nefarious characters congregated here, sharing tales of their exploits and plotting new ones. Sir Marcus listened intently, his keen senses sifting through the cacophony of whispers and drunken laughter for any mention of the plot he had uncovered. The tension in the air was palpable. Every shadow seemed to hold a secret, every glance a hidden message. As Sir Marcus surveyed the crowd, his attention was drawn to a group huddled in the corner of the gallows. Their conversation was hushed, but the urgency in their tones was unmistakable. Edging closer, he overheard fragments of a plot, a scheme to incite rebellion against the crown, to throw London into chaos. Before he could glean more information, a sudden commotion erupted. A thief, recognizing the Black Knight despite his disguise, cried out in alarm. The cry was a catalyst for chaos. Swords were drawn, and the gallows transformed into a battleground. Sir Marcus, his skills honed from years of training and countless battles, fought with a precision and ferocity that spoke of his noble lineage and his commitment to justice. His sword moved with a grace that belied its deadly intent, parrying and striking with lethal accuracy. In the midst of the melee, a cloaked figure lunged at him, a dagger glinting in the moonlight. The duel was swift and brutal. Sir Marcus, sensing a deeper intent behind the attacker's moves, disarmed him, revealing the face of a young nobleman. In his eyes, Sir Marcus saw not just malice, but desperation. The nobleman, gasping for breath, whispered of a meeting, a gathering of conspirators at a noble's estate, a crucial piece of the puzzle that Sir Marcus sought. With the information secured and the immediate threat quelled, Sir Marcus vanished into the night, his presence dissolving into the shadows as quickly as it had appeared. He knew that the nobleman's revelation was a significant lead, one that could unravel the conspiracy that threatened to tear London apart. The next phase of his investigation led him to the heart of London's aristocracy. A grand masquerade ball was to be held at the estate of Lord Ashford, a man whose loyalty to the crown had often been questioned in hushed tones. It was here, behind the guise of opulence and revelry, that the conspirators would gather. Adorned in a mask and attire befitting a nobleman, Sir Marcus infiltrated the ball. The estate was a hive of activity, with guests adorned in elaborate costumes, their faces hidden behind ornate masks. Music filled the air, a sweet melody that masked the undercurrent of intrigue and danger. Sir Marcus navigated through the throng of guests, his eyes and ears alert for any sign of the conspiracy. He engaged in conversations, his inquiries masked by the artful banter typical of such gatherings. Slowly, he began to unravel the threads of the plot. Whispers spoke of dissatisfaction with the crown, of a desire to usurp power, and of a plan that would soon come to fruition. As the night progressed, Sir Marcus identified key figures in the conspiracy, nobles and merchants whose loyalty to the crown was a facade. He overheard a crucial conversation, detailing a plan to capture key members of the royal family, a move that would throw the city into disarray and allow the conspirators to seize control. But before he could act on this information, Sir Marcus was confronted by Lord Ashford himself. The Lord, cunning and sharp-eyed, saw through Sir Marcus's disguise. A tense exchange ensued, a battle of wits and words, as Sir Marcus sought to glean more information while maintaining his cover. The confrontation was interrupted by a sudden uproar from the ballroom. Word had spread of the Black Knight's presence, throwing the ball into chaos. Sir Marcus seized the opportunity to escape, but not before swiping a document from Lord Ashford's study, a list of names and plans that would prove invaluable in thwarting the conspiracy. As he disappeared into the night, the estate behind him a maelstrom of confusion and fear, Sir Marcus knew that the most dangerous part of his mission lay ahead. He had the information he needed to stop the conspirators, but time was of the essence. The fate of London hung in the balance, and the Black Knight was its only hope. Racing through the streets of London, Sir Marcus formulated his plan. He would need to confront the conspirators, to unravel their scheme before it could be set into motion. The document he had secured was the key, but he knew that the coming confrontation would be fraught with peril. The shadows of London whispered of the coming storm, and the Black Knight, a solitary figure against the backdrop of a sleeping city, prepared to face it head on. The battle for London's soul was about to begin, and Sir Marcus, the Black Knight, was ready to lay his life on the line to save his city. Chapter 3. The Masquerade of Shadows. Under the guise of the night, Sir Marcus, known to the city as the Black Knight, found himself standing outside the grand estate of Lord Ashford. The masquerade ball, a grand affair attended by London's elite, was a facade for a more sinister gathering. Cloaked in a disguise that concealed his identity, Sir Marcus prepared to infiltrate the ball to gather information and foil the plot against the crown. As he stepped into the grand hall, a sea of masked faces and elaborate costumes greeted him. The air was thick with the perfume of the nobility, and the sound of a string quartet filled the room. The atmosphere was one of decadence and mirth, but beneath the surface lurked an undercurrent of conspiracy and treason. Sir Marcus moved through the crowd, his senses heightened, acutely aware of the undercurrents flowing around him. His eyes searched for signs of the conspirators, his ears attuned to snippets of hushed conversations that hinted at the plot unfolding in the shadows of the estate. As he navigated the ball, Sir Marcus encountered various figures of the nobility, engaging in conversations laced with double meanings and careful probing. Each interaction was a dance of words, a game of cat and mouse where the slightest slip could reveal his true purpose. In the midst of the ball, Sir Marcus spotted a group of nobles whose hushed tones and furtive glances set them apart from the rest. Approaching them with a guise of casual interest, he managed to insert himself into their conversation. The nobles, their guards lowered by the wine and the festive atmosphere, spoke of their dissatisfaction with the current rule and their desire for change, a change that would come about through drastic measures. From their conversation, Sir Marcus gleaned valuable information about the conspiracy. The plot was to be set into motion the following day, with a coordinated strike against key members of the royal family. The chaos that would ensue would allow the conspirators to seize power and install a new ruler, one who would bend to their will and interests. Armed with this knowledge, Sir Marcus knew he had to act quickly. However, before he could withdraw from the group, Lord Ashford, the host of the ball and the mastermind behind the conspiracy, approached him. Ashford, a man of sharp intellect and keen observation, seemed to see through Sir Marcus's disguise. He engaged Sir Marcus in a conversation filled with veiled threats and probing questions, trying to ascertain his true identity. Sir Marcus, realizing the danger he was in, deftly navigated the conversation, maintaining his facade while seeking an escape. The tension between the two men was palpable. A silent battle of wits and wills played out beneath the guise of polite banter. The situation escalated when a commotion erupted in the ballroom. Word had spread of a disturbance at the gates. The Black Knight had been sighted. The guests were thrown into a panic, the conspirators amongst them fearing their plot had been discovered. Seizing the opportunity, Sir Marcus excused himself from Ashford's company and slipped away into the chaos. He made his way to Ashford's private study, where he hoped to find concrete evidence of the conspiracy. In the study, amidst the opulence and luxury, Sir Marcus found what he was looking for, documents and correspondence outlining the details of the plot, the names of the conspirators, and their plan of action. He quickly pocketed the evidence, but as he turned to leave, he was confronted by Ashford and a group of armed guards. A tense standoff ensued, with Ashford accusing Sir Marcus of espionage and treachery. Sir Marcus, realizing that a fight was inevitable, drew his sword, prepared to defend himself and the evidence he had acquired. What followed was a swift and deadly skirmish. Sir Marcus fought with the skill and prowess befitting the Black Knight, his sword a blur of motion as he parried and struck against his assailants. Despite being outnumbered, he managed to hold his own, his resolve strengthened by the knowledge that the fate of London rested in his hands. In the end, Sir Marcus emerged victorious, though not unscathed. He made his escape from the estate, the documents secured, and the conspirators' plan thwarted, for the moment. As he disappeared into the night, blending once more into the shadows that were his domain, Sir Marcus knew that the battle was far from over. The masquerade ball had been a masquerade of shadows, a facade masking a deadly game of power and treachery. But in the heart of that deception, Sir Marcus had emerged with the truth, a truth that he would use to unmask the conspirators and save the city he swore to protect. The night's events had set the stage for the final act of this dangerous play, a confrontation that would determine the fate of London. The Black Knight, the mysterious guardian of the night, was ready to face whatever perils lay ahead, armed with the truth and his unyielding resolve to protect his city from the clutches of darkness. Chapter 4. Dawn of Justice. The moon hung low over the Tower of London, casting long shadows across its ancient stones. Sir Marcus, known to the city as the Black Knight, made his way towards this historic fortress. It was here that he would confront the mastermind behind the sinister plot to overthrow the crown. His heart was heavy with the knowledge that tonight's actions would shape the future of London. As Sir Marcus approached the tower, he could feel the weight of history surrounding him. This was a place where kings and queens had walked, where secrets and intrigues had played out over centuries. Tonight, it would be the stage for one of the most crucial battles in its long story. The documents Sir Marcus had acquired from Lord Ashford's estate had revealed the full extent of the conspiracy. It was a web of treachery that ensnared some of the most powerful figures in London. They planned to seize key members of the royal family, holding them hostage to bend the crown to their will. Sir Marcus knew he had little time. The conspirators were already within the walls of the tower, their plan set to unfold at dawn. He had to act swiftly and decisively. Cloaked in his black armor, a symbol of his commitment to justice, he entered the tower, ready to confront whatever lay ahead. The Tower of London was a labyrinth of corridors and chambers, each echoing with the whispers of the past. Sir Marcus moved through them with purpose, his every sense alert for signs of the conspirators. As he delved deeper into the fortress, he encountered guards loyal to the conspirators. A series of skirmishes ensued, the clash of swords reverberating through the stone halls. Sir Marcus fought with the skill and precision that had become his trademark, each stroke of his blade bringing him closer to his goal. Finally, Sir Marcus arrived at the chamber where the conspirators had gathered. Lord Ashford was there, along with the other architects of the plot. They were in the midst of finalizing their plans, unaware of the Black Knight's presence. With the element of surprise on his side, Sir Marcus confronted them, the documents he had stolen in hand. The chamber erupted into chaos. Swords were drawn as the conspirators realized their scheme was unraveling. Sir Marcus stood his ground, the embodiment of the justice he sought to uphold. The battle that ensued was fierce and relentless. The clanging of steel and the shouts of men filled the chamber, a cacophony of violence that echoed the turmoil that had gripped London. Amidst the fray, Sir Marcus found himself face to face with Lord Ashford. The Lord was a skilled swordsman, his blade moving with deadly precision. But Sir Marcus fought with something more powerful than skill alone. He fought with a conviction that stemmed from his love for London and his duty to protect its people. The duel between Sir Marcus and Lord Ashford was intense, a dance of death in the dimly lit chamber. Blow was met with counterblow, each man seeking an advantage over the other. But as the battle wore on, it became clear that Sir Marcus was the superior fighter. His strikes were fueled by a righteous fury, a determination to see justice served. In the end, Sir Marcus disarmed Lord Ashford, bringing the Lord to his knees. The other conspirators had been subdued, their plot foiled. With the break of dawn, reinforcements arrived, loyal to the crown, to secure the tower and arrest the traitors. As the sun rose over London, casting its light on the aftermath of the night's battle, Sir Marcus knew that his mission was complete. The conspiracy had been thwarted, the city saved from the brink of chaos. The documents he had acquired provided the evidence needed to bring the conspirators to justice, ensuring that they would answer for their crimes. With his duty fulfilled, Sir Marcus vanished into the morning light, his identity as the Black Knight remaining a secret. He returned to his life as a nobleman, his role as the guardian of London's knights known only to a few. The city of London awoke to a new day, unaware of the battle that had been fought in its name. The streets were calm, the people going about their lives as if nothing had changed. But Sir Marcus knew that London had been on the edge of a precipice, and it was only through his actions that disaster had been averted. The legend of the Black Knight continued to live on in whispers and tales, a shadowy figure who protected the city from the forces of darkness. Sir Marcus continued to watch over London, ever vigilant, ever ready to don the mantle of the Black Knight should the need arise. The dawn of justice had come to London, and the Black Knight, the mysterious guardian of the night, had ensured that the light of truth and righteousness would always prevail.